All right, so a couple quick announcements before we get started today, right? So everybody got my email about the paper, yes? So we all know that the paper is now, please turn that off and put it away, thank you. The paper is now due on Thursday rather than tonight, right? And that I will not be here on Thursday. So what I'm gonna have you do instead, we're gonna be starting with Hamlet, or we're supposed to be starting with Hamlet on Thursday. So I am going to send you a link to a YouTube playlist. It's a production of Hamlet that aired on the BBC a few years ago, starring David Tennant as Hamlet and Patrick Stewart. Because apparently every production of Hamlet that has ever been filmed includes Patrick Stewart playing some role or other. Why? Who knows? The reason I want you to do this rather than something else, I feel like I know the language in Hamlet is going to be difficult for some of you. So seeing it performed will really help you understand what's actually going on in the play and connect those words to specific actions and specific description, right? I know that the first time I saw a Shakespeare play after reading one, the play made a hell of a lot more sense to me than it did just on the page, right? And just sort of one more quick thing to note, I know that the language is a little bit difficult, but Shakespeare does write in an early form of modern English. It is not Old English, it is not Middle English. I just say this because this is a personal pet peeve of mine. If it were Old English, it would sound something like this. Nu schielen Herren Hendrikus Werde, Methodus Mechte and his Mudgetank, Urk Ulderfather, Suehi Undragaves, right? It's a completely different language. In Old English, there are virtually no recognizable modern English words, right? If it was in Old English, you couldn't read it. It is also not Middle English. Middle English sounds like this. Sith in the sage and the asath, what says it the Troia? The burg of Britain then brent to bronze in Ascus. The tulk that the tramus of treason there wrought, what tried for his treachery, the truest on earth. Right, so there are recognizable words in that, right? But it's still not something that you can sit down and read and comprehend, right? So Shakespeare does not write in either of these early forms of English, right? It is modern English. You just have to take your time with it. And, you know, the text does provide a glossary for you. Okay, so that's what you're going to be doing while I'm gone. I'm going to try to get started grading the papers while I'm away, but I can't promise that I will. So they will be graded by the end of next week at the latest. Does anybody have any questions about anything? Okay, don't forget before you leave today also that I want your writing from last time and the articles as well that you worked from, right? So give me the piece you wrote and the two articles that you were writing about when you go. All right, so let's talk about tragedy. What does this word mean? What do you think tragedy is?
Horrible.
Okay. Something horrible. Anybody else want to venture an opinion or a guess?
Yeah.
Okay. What else does the word tragedy evoke for you?
Pardon? A
pain-causing
edict.
Okay. Painful events.
When somebody says tragedy, I usually think like unexpected.
It's okay.
Like if somebody's on their deathbed for a couple months or something, it's usually they die unexpectedly.
Just comes out of the blue. Anybody else? Okay, yeah, in for our purposes, yeah, what we're talking about is a type of play. Right, we're talking about a particular subgenre of drama. And most of these associations that you have with the word tragedy come from early Greek tragedies that have survived. But this is not how the Greeks would have defined tragedy. Tragedy for them specifically referred only to a particular type of play in which horrible things often happened but didn't have to, in which people often died but it wasn't necessary to the genre. The best early definition we have of tragedy comes from a treatise written by the philosopher Aristotle called the Poetics. And the thing that's kind of cool and interesting about the Poetics is that it's not actually like, it's not what we would think of as like an essay or a book. Apparently what it is lecture notes for a speech that he was giving to his own students that have just survived over time. So I don't know. I think that's kind of cool, but you know, what do I know? So the way Aristotle defines tragedy in the Poetics is an action or an imitation of an action. The Greeks defined all art as imitation. That is serious in nature, large in magnitude, and elevated in diction. So what this means, right, is that a tragedy is about an event that is not humorous, that affects a great number of people or a whole society, and that is written in very lofty poetic language. Now, he opposed this to comedy, right, which would have been about trivial situations and written in ordinary language. Greek comedy also tends to be really, really filthy. They had very dirty senses of humor. But the other important thing about tragedy for the Greeks is who it tends to happen to. The characters in tragedy are usually high status people, by and large. Kings, queens, princes, lords, warriors. You don't typically see a lot of common folk in a Greek tragedy. In part, because the Greeks would have considered the elevated diction, the elevated language of tragedy, inappropriate for representing ordinary people on stage. Now, the purpose of a tragedy, as far as Aristotle was concerned, was a communal sense of catharsis. Catharsis is a Greek word that loosely translates to purging. And there's some argument over what Aristotle actually means by this, but here's what most people think he's talking about. Right? People would gather to watch these plays, and they would be filled with pity and fear over the fate of the protagonist in the play. And identifying with that protagonist and his or her fall got the community then to purge all of their negative emotions so they could go on being rational and reasonable throughout the rest of the year. The Greeks, stereotypically, adopted a kind of Spock-like demeanor, right? Overt displays of emotion were frowned upon. Reason and logic were supposed to rule your life. People who behaved emotionally in public were clearly unhinged. So, once a year, during a festival at which these plays were performed, they were allowed to let loose and purge all of those emotions, right? Now, the festival at which they were at which the plays occurred was an annual event, and I'm just going to ask you right off, give this a minute to load, and I'm just going to ask you if any of you recognize the figure in the image that I'm about to show you. Does anybody know who this is? Okay, what if I were to tell you this was a Greek god? Would that help you at all?
It's not Hercules,
no.
The
animal skin's throwing you off, right? You think it's the lion skin Hercules wears? That's actually a leopard skin. He's got vine leaves in his hair. He's carrying a wine cup.
Dionysus?
Yes, this is Dionysus. And Dionysus was the Greek god of what? Anybody?
Looks like nature, but I don't know.
He is actually a fertility god. That is one aspect of his portfolio. Primarily, he's a wine god. But he's also associated with various other properties that we associate with wine, right? So he is not just a god of wine, he is a god of the sorts of things that you do when you've had too much wine. Right, so he is also a god of frenzy, of emotion, and the Greeks always regarded this particular god as being a little bit foreign. Right? Dionysus doesn't really quite fit neatly into the rest of the Greek pantheon. To the extent that scholars used to think he was actually imported from some other culture. That doesn't seem to be the case. It seems that he was, in fact, always a kind of outsider god and god of outsiders. But the shrine to Dionysus, right, the image of the god, was actually kept outside of the city of Athens. Because the sorts of things that he represented, they didn't want in the city during the regular year. But once a year, during a festival called the City Dionysia, the people of Athens would go out, get the image from the shrine, carried into the city with a great big sort of bawdy, raucous parade. So they carry the image, they carry phallic symbols and things of that nature around various kinds of fertility objects. And then they would put on plays. And the goal of the plays, we think, the goal of the tragedies, we think, was, you know, part of this atmosphere of kind of temporary carnival, right? Temporary, unrestrained emotion that they could just push out and go back to being stoic for the rest of the year. I would argue that there's also another aspect to the whole purging thing, but we'll get to that by the time we get to talking about the end of this play. So a tragedy, according to Aristotle, is supposed to consist of a number of different components. Character, plot, thought, dialogue, music, and spectacle. So music and spectacle are probably the least important for our purposes since we're really just reading a play. But suffice to say, right, all Greek plays were essentially what we would think of as musicals, right? They were all performed to musical accompaniments. A lot of the lines would have been chanted, almost ritualistically. In fact, Greek drama has its origins in a religious ritual that was centered on sort of chanting hymns to Dionysus, right? And the person who wrote the best poetic hymn was usually awarded a goat, which was actually a very, very valuable commodity in ancient Athens. So tragedy, actually one proposed etymology for the word is that it comes from Greek tragos, for goat. So tragedy, literally translated from Greek, actually means goat song. So if you take nothing else away from you today, take that with you, goat song. Now, by spectacle, what are meant are not just costumes, which tended to be elaborate. All the actors wore masks made of terracotta that represented different types of characters. But they did also have special effects. In particular, they had a crane called the mechane that could lower characters onto the stage or raise them up off of it. It was usually used for like the entrance of an actor playing a god. So I don't know if any of you have ever heard the phrase Deus ex machina. I will take it from your silence that most of you have actually never heard this phrase. Okay, you have heard this phrase. Do you know what it means, Winbrick?
It's kind of like, there's like a impossible situation, like there's something that saves the day, kind of, like unexpectedly.
Yeah, exactly. Like a writer writes himself into a corner. You know, you see this in movies and TV shows and books. Creates an impossible situation, and then something improbable happens that fixes the situation, right? Literally, this means in Latin, God from the machine. And the term is meant to be critical of Greek and Roman playwrights who would create these kinds of impossible situations and then just have a god come down onto the stage, wave his hand, and fix it. So that's the origin of that anyway. Now, probably the most important aspects of tragedy for Aristotle are character and plot.
A character must be first consistent.
That is, his actions and dialogue in the play have to be consistent with whatever his motivation is, right? And cannot shift wildly back and forth over the course of the play. And he must also be consistent with public attitudes towards that character. Now, why would the public have attitudes towards these characters already? Well, because the Greeks did not invent their own characters or plots. Virtually all Greek tragedies are based on stories from history or mythology, right? So the characters are already familiar to the audience. So if you write a play in which you have a cowardly Achilles or a stupid Odysseus or, you know, a weak and whimpering Hercules, right? That would be considered a flaw. The character has to be consistent with what the public already knows or believes about that character. The character should also be of high status. Tragedy is about important people doing important things. It is not about little people doing trivial things. So all of the characters must be of high social status. And the hero, in particular, should be neither wholly good nor wholly bad, right? You want a hero with whom your audience can identify on some level, so you don't want them to be entirely wicked. They must have some sort of redeeming quality. But they must also possess some sort of character flaw or blind spot that leads to the major event that must occur in the plot. Right? What the Greeks called peripeteia, which we can simply call reversal of fortune. So the main thing that has to happen in the plot of a Greek tragedy is that the hero's fortune must switch either from good to bad, which is the usual method, or from bad to good. Usually as a result of his own mistaken judgment. The Greek word for mistaken judgment, by the way, in case you're interested, is hamartia, H-A-M-A-R-T-I-A. Now, some Greek tragedies end happily. Right? It doesn't always end with everyone dead or everyone in despair. But the majority end unhappily, right? The usual course is for a character whose fortune is riding, who's riding the wheel of fortune high at the beginning of the play, to be down at the bottom of it at the end. So, with that, I think it's probably worth asking, who were the candidates in this play for this role of tragic hero? Which characters in this play do you think might fit the role of protagonist here? The central figure who makes a mistake in judgment. Well, who are the two whose two viewpoints are in conflict throughout the play?
Julius Caesar and... What are you talking about?
Did any of you read the play? No, it's Antigone. It was what we were reading for today. Any of you? Okay, Gabriel, you read it. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Antigone and Creon.
Okay, you also read it then. Okay, that's at least two of you. Okay, so the two viewpoints that we have in conflict here, yes, are the viewpoints of Antigone and Creon. So, in order to understand where each of these characters are coming from, it is helpful to fill in a little bit of backstory that a Greek audience might have been familiar with, right? Or would have been familiar with. So, this is one of a number of plays that deal with the royal family of a Greek city called Thebes. And the Theban royal family in mythology is followed by a curse. Cursed families are actually kind of a big trope in Greek myth. How many of you are familiar with the story of Oedipus? Anybody know the story of Oedipus? Oedipus. Yep. Okay, Oedipus is Antigone's father. His wife, Iocasta, also happens to have been his mother. Now, here's how all of this comes about. Right. Way, way, way back in the past, before the city is founded, a prince by the name of Cadmus, out looking for his sister, is brought to a magic spring, which is guarded by a dragon. He kills the dragon, takes its teeth, sows them in the earth, and they spring up and grow into warriors. With those warriors, he founds a city, the city of Thebes. But that dragon was sacred to Ares, the god of war, who was pretty pissed that Cadmus killed his dragon. So Cadmus and all of his descendants are then cursed by the god. He's like, fuck you, you killed my dragon, right? Show you. And every issue of your loins from here forth. So, by the time we get to Oedipus, right? Iocasta's first husband is a guy by the name of Laius. He is king of Thebes, good for him. And he consults an oracle. Now, oracles in the Greek world were women who lived in these sort of sacred caves, who would be visited by petitioners looking for the answers to haunting questions, like what's going to happen to me in the future, and things of that nature. And the oracle would then take a whole lot of magic mushrooms and detail her cryptic visions to this person. It was supposed to give them some kind of guidance. Well, when Laius consults the oracle upon the birth of his first son, as was customary, the oracle tells him that the boy is going to grow up to kill his father and marry his mother. Now, we can't have that happening. So, Laius decides that it would be wrong to actually kill the child, who has as of yet done nothing wrong. So he follows the usual Greek method of disposing of unwanted people when you don't actually want their blood on your hands. You simply leave them someplace where they are likely to die and let fate take its course, right? Then it's not really your fault. You didn't kill them, right? The gods can't blame you for that. But to help fate along its course, Laius has the child's ankles pierced and a leather thong tied through them to make it harder for him to get away, right? So this is actually where the name Oedipus comes from. Oedipus in Greek means swollen foot. And the character, when represented on stage, usually walked with a limp. So, because he is not fated to die, the baby doesn't. He's picked up by a kindly shepherd who takes him to the royal family of another kingdom, the kingdom of Corinth, where he is raised by the childless king and queen as their own son. As an adult, he goes and consults the same oracle his biological father had consulted, and it tells him the same thing, right? You are going to kill your father and marry your mother. He doesn't know he's adopted. So he says, oh, I can never go back to Corinth again, right? I have to make sure this doesn't happen. I'll go somewhere else. On the road, he meets a nasty, snooty old man who demands that he get out of the way. Oedipus says, no, make me. They fight, and he kills the old man and every member of his entourage except for one guy who gets away. He makes his way to the city of Thebes, defeats a monster that has been plaguing the city, and as a reward, gets married to the recently widowed but still relatively young and beautiful queen. They have 4 children together. A plague hits the city of Thebes because apparently the old king Laius had been murdered and his murderer has gone unpunished. Oedipus resolves to catch that murderer, to use his wits, which he used in defeating the monster, to bring justice back to the city of Thebes and end the plague. Seers and oracles confirm, oh yes, Laius' murderer is still at large. He is in the city of Thebes, and he's wearing his crown and sleeping with his wife. Oh, and by the way, yes, he's also Laius' son. So Oedipus learns the truth of his identity, and the horrible things he's done all at once, right? The prophecy becomes fulfilled in that one moment. So he blinds himself and goes out wandering into the wilderness. His wife, who realizes what's happened before he does, hangs herself. And the 4 children that they left behind are more or less left to figure things out for themselves. So they have twin sons, Eteocles and Polynices, and also 2 daughters, Antigone and Ismene. Eteocles and Polynices, being twins, decide that they will share the throne of Thebes, right? One will rule for 7 years, then his brother will rule for 7 years, and so on and so forth, until one of them dies. Eteocles gets to go first. And at the end of his 7 years, perhaps predictably, he does not want to give up the throne. So Polynices raises an army to come and take back his birthright. The 2 of them end up killing each other in battle. And that's where we are at the beginning of Antigone. Right, the two sons of Oedipus have just killed one another. Eteocles, it's been declared, will, because he died defending Thebes, will receive a hero's burial. Right, nice big funeral at state expense. Polynices, his brother, will not receive any burial. Will be left out on the battlefield to be devoured like carrion because he died as a traitor. Now, this is an enormously big deal to the Greeks. On the one hand, like, the Greek afterlife isn't especially that, like, what happens to you in the afterlife isn't especially important, right? Everybody gets the same afterlife for the Greeks. There's no good afterlife or bad afterlife, right? It doesn't matter what sort of person you were. What does matter is that your spirit is put to rest after you die, so that you do not return to plague your living relatives. And if you do not receive a proper burial ritual, right, which usually meant the body being anointed with oil, wine being poured out for the underworld spirits, and a coin being placed either on your eyes or under your tongue to carry you across the river that separated the mortal world from the underworld, then your spirit was going to continue to linger on this side for eternity, right? You would never have any kind of closure. You would never have. You would never cross over, right? So that's the fate that has been decided for Polynices by the new king Creon, who is Iocasta's brother. So the curse of this particular house has played out to this generation, right? And Antigone and Ismene, we first see at the beginning of the play, going outside the city gates. Let's go through this opening scene a little bit. Can I get two volunteers? Can I get an Antigone and an Ismene? Just turn to the first page of the play. And, you know, since all the actors in Greek plays were men, we can do completely gender-neutral casting here, right? Whoever wants to read Antigone or Ismene, right? It doesn't matter. Whoever wants to volunteer will take.
What page is
it on? Which book do you have? You have the red one? 1552. If you have the green one, it's on 1211. Any volunteer?
I'll read Antigone.
Okay. Gabriana, you read Antigone. If I can get an Ismene. All right. Joanne, you be Ismene. All right. So, starting from Ismene, my dear sister.
Ismene, my dear sister, whose father was my father. Can you think of any of all the evils that stem from Oedipus? Is that how you say
it? Oedipus, yep.
Oedipus. Mm-hmm. From Oedipus? That Zeus does not bring to pass for us while we yet live. No pain, no ruin, no shame, and no dishonor. But have I seen it in our mischief, yours and mine? And now what is the proclamation that they tell of, made late by a commander publicly? So all the people, do you know it? Have you heard of it? Don't you notice when the evil is due to enemies? are headed toward those we love.
Not a word that take me, for those we love, even sweeter bitter, has come to see me since the moment when we lost our two brothers. On one day by their hands dealing mutual death, since the RDF army laid in this past night. I know nothing further, nothing of better fortune or more destruction.
I knew it well, that is why I sent for you, to come outside the palace gate to listen to me properly.
What is that? Certainly your words come with dark thoughts.
Yes, indeed, for those two brothers of ours, in burial has not Creon honored the one, dishonored the other. Antigone, they say he has used justly with lawful rights and hid him in the earth to have his honor among the dead men there, but the unhappy corpse of
Polynices.
He has proclaimed to all senses, they say, no man may hide in a grave nor mourn in funeral, but leave unwept, unburied, a dainty treasure for the birds that see him, for their feast delight. This is what they say, the worthy Creon has proclaimed for you and me. For me, I tell you, he comes here to clarify to the unknowing his proclamation. He takes it seriously. For whoever breaks the edict, death is prescribed, and death by stoning publicly. There you have it. Soon you will show yourself as noble both in your nature and your birth, or yourself as base, all of noble patents.
The things are as you say, poor sister. How can I better them? Tie loose or tie the knot?
Decide if you will share the work the deed.
What kind of danger is there? How far have your thoughts gone?
Here's the hand. Will you help it to lift the dead man?
Would you bury him? What is forbidden to see?
At least he is my brother and yours too. Though if you deny him, I will not prove false to him.
You are so headstrong. Creon has forbidden me.
It is not for him to keep me from my home.
Oh God, consider, sister, how our father died, hated and infamous. How he brought to light his own offenses. How he himself struck out the sight of two eyes. His own hand was there. Exhumator. Then mother and wife, two names and one did shame bodily on her life on twisted cords. Third, our brothers on the single day, poor riches themselves worked out their mutual doom. Each killed the other, hand against brother's hand. Now there are only the two of us left behind, and see how miserable our end shall be if the teeth of law we shall transgress against the sovereign's decree and power. You ought to realize we are only women, not men in nature to fight against men, and that we are ruled by those who are stronger, to obedience in this and even more painful matters. And I do indeed beg those beneath the earth to give me their forgiveness, since force constrains me, that I should yield in this to the authorities. Extravagant action is not simple.
I will not urge it now, nor if you wanted to act, would I be glad to have it with me. But as you choose to be, but for myself, I myself will bury him. It will be good to die, so doing, I shall lie by his side, loving him as he loved me. I shall be a criminal, but a religious one. The time in which I must please those that are dead is longer than I must please those of this world. For there I shall lie forever. You, if you like, can cast this honor on what the gods have honored.
Okay, you guys can stop there. So, very good, both of you. Thank you. Give him a hand. Take some courage, right? Okay, so the decree is, as we said, that Eteocles will be buried a hero, Polynices will not be buried at all. Right, left to rot as a traitor. So, what does Antigone propose to do about this?
To bury him.
Yeah, in defiance of the law, right? In defiance of the rule made by the king, she is going to go out and bury her brother. She doesn't care that the law deems him a traitor, right? To her, that's not what matters. What matters is that he is still her brother, living or dead, traitor or hero. And that as her brother, she owes certain familial duties to him. Now, what viewpoint then does Ismene represent? What's Ismene's role in this? Is she going to help her sister bury their brother? No. She's not going to participate. Why not?
Because it's forbidden.
Yeah, because she's afraid of the law, right? And I think it's interesting to note, you know, in terms of broad themes in the play, that last long speech that you read out, Jawan, where Ismene, you know, notes, you know, you ought to realize we are only women, not meant in nature to fight against men, and that we are ruled by those who are stronger to obedience in this and even more painful matters. Now, Greek society was rigidly male-dominated. Right, all the levers of power in any Greek city-state were held by men. Women were regarded as inferior creatures that were a kind of necessary evil for producing children. Right, the Greek stereotype of woman was that she was hysterical, over-emotional, not particularly intelligent, and sex-crazed. So what Ismene is doing is participating in and reinforcing these particular stereotypes. Right? Like, I am too weak to fight against the law of men, right? What can I do? I'm only a woman. We'll hear very similar kinds of speeches coming out of the mouth of Creon, the king. So I want to show you a short clip from a British TV production of this from the mid-80s. This is the scene in which Antigone and Creon confront one another. And I just want you to watch, observe, and see to what extent you can sum up each character's viewpoints. Right? What does Creon value most? What does Creon think is most important? Right? On what basis does he rest his claims? And how does Antigone counter his claims? Right? And whose argument do you think is the stronger?
A dust storm which swept along the valley, tore all the leaves over the trees, blotted out the whole sky, and completely blinded us. It seemed like some terrible manifestation of the gods, and you had to shut your eyes to endure it at all. And then suddenly, it stopped. And when the air had cleared, we opened our eyes and saw this girl standing there beside the grave, a sort of wailing as though she were in pain, or maybe anger. Just like a bird that comes back to the nest and finds the egg smashed or the fledgling's gone. That's what it sounded like. She was standing there, looking at the naked body, and screaming and cursing the monsters who had done such a thing. Us, of course. Then she crouched down and picked up a few handfuls of the dry dust and scattered it on him. She carried an urn, a small bronze ceremonial thing, and she poured it over the dead man 3 times. Honey and wine and stuff it in, I suppose. All the proper ritual for a funeral, anyway. Well, as soon as we saw that, we all came charging down and arrested her on the spot. She wasn't frightened or anything. She stood her ground. So then we formally charged her with a crime. This and the one before. And she admitted she'd done them both. We were all relieved to hear that, I can tell you. But sorry, too, in a way. It's very nice to get out of trouble yourself. Not so nice when you see someone else up to the neck in it. Someone you've got no quarrel with. But still, your own life comes first, I reckon. You've got to look after number one.
Soldier, get out. You're free to go back to your unit. Count yourself lucky. Now, tell me a simple yes or no. Did you hear of my order forbidding the burial?
Of course I heard it. How could I not?
Yet you dared to disobey the law.
Yes, I did. Because it's your law, not the law of God. Natural justice, which is of all times and places numinous, not material, a quality of Zeus, not of kings, recognizes no such law. You are merely a man, mortal, like me, and laws that you enact cannot overturn ancient moralities or common human decency. They speak the language of eternity, are not written down, and never change. They are for today, yesterday, and all time. No one understands where they came from, but everyone recognizes their force, and no man's arrogance or power can make me disobey them. I would rather suffer the disapproval and punishment of men than dishonor such ancient truths. I shall die, of course, sometime. Whether you make laws or not, if my death comes sooner rather than later, I shall welcome it. My life has been misery, is misery now, and I shall be more than happy to leave it. There will be no pain and no despair in that. But to leave my mother's son out there in the open, unburied, that would have been unendurable. I could not have borne it. Whereas this, I shall endure. By your judgment, of course, I'm a fool. But by mine, the judge is the criminal, not the accused.
This is her father talking. Stubborn. Like him, she won't give way. Not even with the whole power of the state against her.
Well, we shall see. Any man can be broken. And often the most committed and determined break soonest. Even iron, you know, left lying in the fire too long becomes over-tempered and will snap as soon as a little pressure is applied. You can break it in pieces. And the wildest horse, in the end, submits to the bit and halter just like the rest. People without power, ordinary citizens, must necessarily obey those in authority over them. This woman is very proud. That was obvious in the first place when she broke the law, and is even clearer now. She glories in the crime she has committed, and insults me to my face as well as ignoring my decree. If she is allowed to flout the law in this way, all authority in the state will collapse. I will not have that. There will be no exchanging of roles here, me playing the woman while she plays the king. She is my niece, my sister's child. But I am the law, and that responsibility is above kinship. Were she even closer, the closest, my own daughter, my duty would be plain. Well, the law has its weapons, and they will strike at her, and at her sister, too, her accomplice, I've no doubt, in this illegal act, to the full extent of the punishment prescribed. The other one is Mamie. Bring her here. I saw her in the corridor talking to herself some moments ago, and I suppose in tears. Guilty consciences, you see, can never be hidden completely. The human face reveals conspiracies before they are enacted again and again. There's nothing more disgusting than the confessed criminal who tries to justify his actions, as this woman has done here today.
I'm bored with your talk. Kill me and have done with it.
Well, there's no hurry. The progress of the law is majestic and inexorable. And that satisfies me.
Why waste so much time? Nothing you say will be of the slightest interest to me, and my arguments you will not listen to. I've done what I said I'd do. I've buried my brother. I aspire to no greater honor. And if I am to be famous, let it be for that. All these senators of yours, they all agree with me in their hearts. But there's no gag like terror, is there, gentlemen? And kings must have their way, both in word and action, one way or the other.
You're quite mistaken. None of my subjects anywhere in the city thinks as you do.
They all do, but they're too afraid to speak.
Not at all, and you should be ashamed, setting yourself up against the majority, disregarding the will of the people.
I love my brother. I honor him dead as I loved him living. There's no shame in that.
The one he murdered, wasn't he your brother?
My mother bore them both, and I love them both.
If you honor one, you insult the other.
Neither of those dead men would say that.
Eteocles would. His brother was a traitor. Does he merit no greater respect than that?
But he was not an animal! They both died together, and they were both men!
Yeah, the one died defending his country while the other traitorously attacked him.
They'd have their rights, and we have our duties towards them, dictated by common decency.
It's good and better to be honored equally. Where are our values? Patriotism, civic duty?
Death is another country. Such things may not be valued there, may even be crimes.
An enemy is still an enemy, dead or alive.
No, I don't think so. I have love enough to share. No hate for anyone.
Very well. Share your love by all means. Share it with the dead. I wish them well of it. Women must learn to obey as well as men. They can have no special treatment. Law is law, and will remain so while I am king. And no woman will get the better of me.
Okay, so because any production of a play is necessarily also an interpretation of it. A couple of things I think it would be worth thinking about just that are specific to the presentation here. First, you notice how Creon is dressed, the actor playing Creon. What's his costume look like? Yeah, he's wearing an army officer's uniform, right? Now, what kinds of political leaders like to walk around wearing military uniforms?
Dictators.
Usually military dictators, yeah. So he's dressed here in this production as a military dictator, yeah. And you may have noticed in the background those pictures as well, like the big pictures of the dead heroic brother. Right. Sort of cult of martyrdom thing. The sort of thing that is also common in intensely nationalistic dictatorships, right? Now, what about the arguments here Creon is making against Antigone's action? What do his arguments seem to rest on? What is most important to him? Pardon? The law, yes. Law and order. And what does the law seem to mean to him? How does he define law?
That it's above the kinship that she is backing him.
Yeah. Law is emotionless, right? Without favoritism, must treat all citizens equally, whether or not they are related to the king. Right, you know, he specifically says, like, look, it doesn't matter that she's my niece, right? It doesn't matter that she's a member of my family. She has to suffer the same consequences as anyone else would who committed the same crime. Emotionless, no favoritism. And what else does he seem to rest his definition of law upon?
That it's like his word. It's
like, yeah, that he, as the chief citizen, right, as the king, his word is law. what he says goes. And does he seem to be able to deal with disagreement very well? Yeah, the law contained in his own person. Does not brook dissent. Right, when Antigone says, you know, all of these senators of yours, right, they all feel as I do, but they're too scared to say it, right? Creon is quick to respond, no one thinks as you do. The majority is with me. There can be no dissent. Everyone has to fall in line. Everyone has to obey. Now, given the situation Creon has inherited, is his attitude completely unreasonable? It may seem to us unsympathetic, right? But what has just happened in the city that he now rules? What's sparked this conflict in the first place? Yeah, civil war, right? So he's trying to hold together a war-torn city-state. And as he sees it, the best way to do so is strict law and order measures, right? No mercy, no forgiveness. We have to get everyone back in line. Now, he does reveal another particular attitude in these speeches as well. Who does he seem, in general, what class of citizenry does he seem to have very little respect for? Yeah, very little respect for women, right? And in fact, he keeps saying he will not be made a woman, right? He's not going to let a woman get the better of him. So we see a particular blind spot develop there, right? Now, what about Antigone? What's the basis for Antigone's worldview? What's most important to her?
Marrying a brother properly.
Pardon?
Marrying a brother properly.
Yeah, that her brother must receive a proper burial. And what view of the world is underlying that belief?
Religion.
Okay, right, that religion is important to her. Pardon? Family, yes. Exactly the thing that Creon says doesn't matter, right? In terms of the law. Right, the thing that is most important, the ties that are most important to Antigone are not ties of citizenship, but ties of kinship, right? Ties of blood, ties of family. It doesn't matter to me that he was a criminal. What matters is that he was a human being and my brother. As such, he should still be honored in death. As such, he should still receive a funeral. Now, which viewpoint is presented more sympathetically here? Who is it easier to side with?
Antigone.
Yeah, it is easier to side with Antigone, in part because her argument has greater emotional appeal, right? Creon's argument comes off, particularly to a contemporary audience, as a little bit cold and robotic, right? Machine law that must be rigidly applied everywhere. Whereas Antigone's makes us feel a little bit more kind of warm and fuzzy, right? She has love enough to give to everyone. Great. But does the play agree with Antigone? And that's a little bit more difficult to figure out, but there are a couple of little clues as we go through it that can help us figure out where its sympathies actually lie. When Antigone is sentenced to death, Creon does not, in fact, take responsibility for killing her. Now, those of you who did make it through this, what does he do instead? What does he decree will happen to her instead? He's not going to execute her.
He put her in a cave.
Yeah. I'm not going to kill you myself. I'm just going to lock you up in this tomb here, right? Now, does this sound familiar? What's he doing? Well, she's already buried. It's a tomb, right?
Yeah.
So she's already ready-made burial site, right where she is. What happened to Antigone's father when he was a baby?
His dad did the same thing to him as his uncle was doing.
Yeah. Now, Oedipus was simply left somewhere where he was likely to die, because of the time he was an innocent, right? And Laius, his father, did not want his hands stained with innocent blood. So the fact that Creon, rather than killing Antigone, or decreeing that she will be killed, leaving her in this tomb, what does that suggest about how sure he is about whether she's guilty or not, whether she's really committed a crime? Yeah, he's not, right? He's wavering a bit on this here. It's like, I'm just going to put her someplace where she's probably going to starve to death. And if she does, then that was the will of the gods, and so forth. I'm clean, I'm absolved. And if it's the will of the gods that she'll survive. And either way, no trouble for me. But yeah, having her executed in that way indicates that he's unsure of what he's doing. He's unsure that what he's doing is actually just. And indeed, you know, when Antigone commits suicide in the cave, and her fiancé, Creon's son, only surviving son, also commits suicide in the cave upon seeing her dead body. And Creon's wife, upon hearing of the death of her last surviving son, also commits suicide. Who is ultimately left bereft of any family? Creon, the guy who said that he didn't value it, right? The guy who said that the state and the law were more important. So, I think that while the play is called Antigone, it's really more about Creon and about what happens to Creon and about how his particular blind spot, his errors in judgment, lead to the elimination of his entire family. Right? He loses everything. So we talked about this idea of catharsis or purging at the beginning of class. And as I said, it's usually taken to mean a kind of communal purging of your negative emotions, right? Everybody goes to the tragedy, they all cry and scream together, and then go back to their normal everyday routines. But I would argue that most of these tragedies also end up purging difficult people or families from a community. The death of Creon's of Antigone and of all the rest of Creon's relatives means that this cursed house of Cadmus is done for, right? They're finally fully punished for their ancestor killing that damn dragon so many years ago, right? The will of the gods works its way out to get these troublesome people out of the community. And you will find that most Greek tragedies actually work in the same way. The troublemakers, whether they're sympathetic troublemakers like Antigone or not, end up purged. Everybody out. And the community can then just go back to normal. All right, so anybody have any questions about this? All right, then I will send you the link to that BBC production of Hamlet. Right, watch that over the weekend. Read the play. Please, please read the play. We will talk about it when we come back on Tuesday. All right.